May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be always pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Take a seat. I remember sitting around a table for meetings, and we at that stage had a practice that we'd start every meeting with some sort of question or query, think of something good about the week or something like that. And one day I asked the question, what does your name mean? And a lot of people were sort of slightly confused. A couple of people knew what their names meant. I thought one of the better ones was somebody said, my name means incredibly handsome. It didn't, but I thought that was a good answer. So when we name, say, our children, we often think about naming them after someone, don't we? And we tend to name them after someone we admire or like, because we hope that in some way our child will grow up to embody that. You know, you tend not to name your child after someone who's been a bit of a dropkick, for want of a better use of a term. Look, there is another tradition. Growing up in South Africa, I had a friend who was Zulu, and his name was Tulani. And it depends on how it's said. So if mum's cranky and she goes, Tula, it means be quiet. But it also means peaceful. The hope that he would grow up to be a man of peace. See, names aren't just labels. Quite often they're hopes as well. And I want to use the word destiny, but I'm not. Instead, I'm going to use the word vocation. Vocation is that thing that God calls us to. We often, nowadays we talk about vocational studies as sort of, you know, like when you go and train to be a chef or a mechanic or something like that. But the word means that which God calls us to. It's that part of our lives that we are shaped by character to do. And so our names are, in a sense, a hope for our true vocation, our true relationship and calling with God. In fact, one might think that ideally they describe our soul. Now, soul is one of those slightly tricky concepts that we get in Scripture. So spirit is that which gives life. If a thing is alive, it has spirit, and that spirit comes from God. If it has no spirit, it is not alive. It's essentially life. Soul is something different. It's not like at whatever stage God chooses, you get a soul, it goes popped into your body in some way, and that's it. No, our soul is something that matures. It develops, it grows through our interaction with God and with God's creation. And so in a sense, our name and our soul have a connection. They are ideally our vocation, our relationship with God. And it's an amazing thing that Abram's name is changed by God. He goes from Abram to Abraham, and it's a small but important shift. Because it says, in this relationship he has with God, he is able to find a more truthful name that reflects his vocation. And Jesus is talking, and he says, what good is it for someone to gain the whole world, yet forfeit their soul? What good is it if you gain all the stuff in the world, but you lose that which gives it value? I have more stuff than I need. I have more coffee cups than I need. I have more coffee cups. I have so many coffee cups at home that if I were to use all the coffee cups for visitors and guests, I wouldn't have enough space in the house. But I have some special ones. And they're not special because they're, you know, made of gold. They're not special because of their intrinsic valuableness. They're special because they were given to me by people who are precious to me. And I'm sure you have similar things. I'm sure. You see, they gain value not because of their worldly wealth, but because they speak to our soul, because of our relationship with others and with God. And Jesus says, what good is it if you gain all the stuff, but you lose your soul, you lose your relationship with God and with others? Because then it's just dust. It's not, it has no value except for what you can sell it for. And as an example, we have the life of Christ, who continues to develop his soul. Not so long ago, we read about the baptism of Jesus and his time in the desert. We read about Jesus' ongoing development of his relationship with the Father in prayer and in acting out his vocation. And today, in the gospel, he warns his friends, his disciples, and the two words are not always synonymous. He warns them that a time will come when I have to give up the whole world for my soul, for my relationship with God and with what God the Father desires for me, my vocation. So for us, there's a lot in there. One, there's the opportunity to go home and figure out what your name means. Maybe find out what your parents were hoping for when they named you that. My parents were hoping I would grow up to be like one of Jesus' disciples. I'm working on it. So there we go. A little piece of homework. And a piece of trivia if it ever comes up in a conversation. But the more important piece of homework is, what work do I need to do to strengthen and build my soul? You already have the gift of the Spirit from God because you're alive. Now make it valuable. Now imbue it with richness so that your soul may grow. And the ultimate sign of a soul that has grown is one that is able to give spirit to others, to enrich the spirit, the life of those around us, as Christ does for us. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Amen.